Information I'm getting now. So we begin with apologies for absence.
And then you've got more house.
I'm not aware of where Tom's at, but I'm sure if he's caught on the most person, then he's said his apology.
If there are more apologies, we'll be going to be with you, Tom. And if he does, we will accept the apology. Next item is the declaration.
Can you put the microphone on, please, because I can't hear you.
Use your mic, please.
Thank you.
I'm terribly sorry.
Thank you.
I thought I was speaking so loud, it wouldn't matter, but thank you for warning me. Members' Code of Conduct, are there any declarations of interest? We've got two. The gentleman will go first, just to be under etiquette.
Very kind. Work out how to turn this on. On the procurement use of procedure rules of reports, section 5, between page 23 to 34, there are two mentions of CWP, which are dated 9th and 23rd of March. I'm a member of the Council of Governors of CWP. As far as I know, I've had no involvement or discussion in any of those matters that's referred to here, but for care, I should mention that I'm a government.
I'm an employee of CWP and one of the services, a nurse practitioner service for the homeless, is one of the teams that I look after. So I will be leaving the room when we discuss the item after discussion with the public.
Any more? In that case, we move on to the minutes. Is somebody prepared to move that they are true?
Was one of the correct minutes?
Just my name. Did I correct my initials? My initials should be E-A-Y, not L-Y.
Oh, wait.
As in Elizabeth.
As in Elizabeth.
Okay, thanks for all our attention to that.
And I'll second the minutes.
Thank you, Ron. So we've been moved and seconded. Are we all happy with them?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Sure, that next later. Audit has also recently been completed at the Council's new remote data centre located in the emergency channel buildings of Wirral. We wanted to evaluate the effectiveness of controls in operation that are managed by emergency channel staff rather than our own local council staff. Finding did indicate that overall security was reasonably effective. However, there were a number of actions that have been identified and agreed with the NISO over there to improve the arrangements and to strengthen controls. Team is also currently, I should add, experiencing in my team quite high volume of referrals of a fairly complex nature. May have an impact upon the delivery account delivery as we move forward. At this moment in time, it isn't having a significant impact, but I will endeavour to continue to monitor that and report any issues on the state of care. Can I also draw your attention to section 3.3 on page 15 of the report, where the table identifies information related to rewards where recommended actions included or reports remain outstanding. The table is attached to appendix 1, and it is again fairly pleasing to note that all of the items that are on 2 are currently bright rated as amber, indicating that action is handled and the progress has been made. It is encouraging because there are quite a sizable number of audit reports that get produced in any given period with a significant number of recommendations. That report gives you some assurance that the reports that are producing the actions will agree with that, not the impacts that we get in green time scales. These are the official reports. Section 3.4 on page 60 of the report identifies information relating to the performance of the internal service. You'll note that delivery of the audit plan is the closest to the target. We discussed at the previous meeting like a shortfall that was primarily as a result of a lot of work that was in the pipeline, but certainly suggested that there may have been some concerns over the we were pretty much back on track, and I'm happy with how that performance is over this time of year. With the proviso that said that there are a number of that may of course have some performance in that, but I continue to say to monitor that. Feedback from clients and management remains very good. All key actions identified on the course being agreed with clients, and the satisfaction levels do remain consistently high, which is again very important. Finally, in section 3.5 on page 6 of the report, I do identify some of the ongoing improvements that we continually try to make to sort of how we go about delivering the audit. This is a regular feature, and a lot of those items included within there will be familiar to members because the of a constant sort of re-evaluation, reassessment of how we do what we do and make sure we comply with the current best practice, the accepted internal standards that are out there, given that to some way to do. That's probably as much as I need to say about the report itself. I'm very happy to take any questions that the members might have.
The first kind of vote was Councillor Ron Abbey.
Thank you, Chair. Can I just on page 20, the wall of the it's sitting at amber. There are no issues with this. Thank you. But it says final report issued, action plan, and customer satisfaction survey contained. Is that not conflict with the amber then? Is that say it was green and stone? What's the actual state of play with this?
What I would say is that the amber indicates at the time of the report going out that all those actions were agreed. There was a time to get identified with those actions. We as internal audit at that point then had the opportunity to go back and reassess the actual implementation of the recs and the effectiveness of the actions that were being managed. As we speak this week, the follow-up is place down there on the floor where there will be some testing undertaken to verify what actions were taken and the impact process. Yes. So in the next final report that you get, there will be a very clear indication. And there's every indication that amber will change to green. They're providing verbal assurances that it's green as things stand at this point in time, but we just need to verify that.
Yeah.
So,
just a follow-up from that. What is the actual time scale between there's been a conclusion maybe. And secondly, could it not be better if you put it in a report to say this is due to with his or check what it has to do with. So we can actually understand why it's such a number as opposed to it saying you can't not report. Can't report means that it's finished. So sometimes the language is easy to assist with as it says this is going. Issue the matters in October or December or whatever. You should get some time scales to judge these things.
As you see from the report itself, the implementation time scale was dated in March 2018, so those actions that we agreed at the time of the report in January should have been implemented in March. We haven't gone back to do the follow-up because there are the end of the day, I don't know, we're sort of going out this week, I think, so we'll verify if those. What this report normally contains are two elements to it. There's an element of completed audits, and there's a secondary page of follow-up audits completed, which gives an updated sort of rag rating. Because the follow-up is completed for this particular period, when all of the actions have been implemented, there's nothing outstanding, there isn't that secondary page, so it probably does potentially confuse me. I understand what he's saying. I'll try and find a way of presenting this in a way that takes on board the comments that you make, because you do make a good point on that.
I think sometimes when you've gone and visited someone, yeah, and you've had that assurance and reassurance, and you feel like having, that's why you sit around that. The agency thought that is not those relevant. But we don't know that, because it doesn't tell us. Of course, we're concerned, it's an outstanding issue. And we know our past record of this. This venue has not always been good for some of the internal audits you've done.
Yeah.
Okay. But it's that pattern that we have to understand that. It's whether your reassurance to say that you're happy with the progress being made, and you are going back at the earliest opportunity, is probably the way to deal with it. Other than we think it's sitting around, but it's been sitting around for some time. Why is it not moved one way or the other? That's the concern we get. It's just about, you know, the committee, the eye has been taken off the ball, and I was looking back here as a rep, and then this committee has huge concerns about these things. And trying to preempt that,
yeah,
by that information to say, well, you're giving us the reassurance of the officer.
I'll look at how I can factor that in.
Okay, now I've got Angela, David, and Phil Gilchrist, and then Jeff. So, Angela.
Okay, thank you. My first question is about section, is it 2C? Is that your last thing? It should be 3.2C on page 15, where you're talking about a number of referrals that are fairly complex in each. Now, I acknowledge that we're in the public arena at the moment, so the way we're going to be considered two things really. Are they related, and is it something that certainly our chair is aware of?
Through you, Jim. They're not related. There are four separate pieces of work on the open moment that would need to be referred to us. The chair is aware of them. In due course, you will be advised of the outcomes of them and any actions that are appropriate in relation to those.
Okay, thank you.
I
just wanted to say that I think it highlights, you know, certainly when you come and talk about the work on the year, what the team is going to be doing, I always say it's important to have that kind of spare time earmarked, if you like. So I think it just shows that it is important to keep that kind of protected spare time so that you can respond to requests like this.
We do, within the plan, provide any elements of contingency, like which runs to the region of 100 days. However, as a result of the work that we're undertaking at the moment, we're fast approaching now. It's fairly unprecedented, just circumstances.
Yeah, very briefly, Chair, I was going to ask the same question actually as Angela asked. It seemed to have gone beneath my radar, this on referrals. I wondered if you could give us any brief examples of the types of things you're referring to, or whether it's too confidential to go into. I picked up the idea that you were saying they were a fairly complex nature, which implied a lot of work has to go into them. I wondered if you could give us just a flavour of what those type of referrals are, that it's going to be my regular.
It's very difficult in a public arena to be too specific. What I can say is that at least one of the pieces of work has resulted in a fairly significant number of related issues, everything from finance to stock maintenance to management of affected records to support. So, predominantly of a financial nature, sort of example, but many different strands can think so. It involves a significant amount of work to try and identify where the evidence is and unearth that evidence and to trawl back through potentially a number of years worth of transactions to give us absolute assurance in relation to the extent of the problem and what needs to be done to address that. So I can't really say more than that at this point in time, but I will be providing you with something via the Bible please in due course or through yourself. So
thank you,
Jerry.
Phil.
Thank you. I suppose to start where we just left off, because it was in my mind, but whether it would be beneficial towards the end of the meeting for the committee to actually go in Cambridge to hear more about these things so that we can learn something that would be possibly helpful. I'll leave that to you, Chair. Otherwise, just having comments that this complex nature just sends hairs running and makes us ponder. I wonder what it's all about. I'll leave that in the air for a bit. Really want to explore the Wirral Growth Company. Probably have more to say on a later item, but it's apparent that there's a workload associated with setting this up. Lots of meetings to be serviced, and later on in the report on local authority companies, we're told that the local authority must recover its costs from any company. So I'm assuming that the income will be the development of sites, which were listed in about June last year in the current report, which some of which emerged in a very detailed document around about January, February this year, and then some of which went to a special cabinet meeting at the college in March. So there's clearly lots of things going on, though we're not sure the formal cabinet meeting to launch whatever the result of all that is has actually happened yet. But it struck me that if there's a lot of work going on, which we, being with, have to be involved in, it must be costing hours of staff time, and will potentially cost hours of staff time, and it should be recovered from that body. I look forward to a comment on that.
Interesting comment that you make. And it's certainly there's a sizable chunk of work that's been identified within the plan for this year, you may recall. So clearly sort of strong emphasis on the work that we need to undertake that was a basis of governance, this kind of nature, identifying, sitting on the board and asking better questions of in relation to sort of how those risks were being controlled, what the governance was being controlled. We spent some time with the company directors coming. We've got sort of revisited the sort of headquarters to make sure that we have access to all the relevant sort of records that we need to assure ourselves that the arrangements are sort of or that the governance arrangements are locked together going forward. You in terms of billing, charging the company, it is something that we will have to take on board at the moment. This precise point in time, yeah, there isn't that arrangement in place.
Yes.
Major, just to finish up on that one. Maybe something to return to at some later point, but two things to just be aware of at the moment. Firstly, there isn't a Wirral Growth Company partnership at the moment because it's not been incorporated. And also, it's called company, but it's a partnership. So it's the way that it's set up will be set out in a partnership. And be subject to slightly different rules. Because it's not a company.
And I'm sure, Chair, Mr. McCourt has answered one of the questions. He asked about the council about the Wirral Growth Company. He told it wasn't being set up. I'm sure we as a committee, what are the questions I'd like to ask, but we as a committee would want assurance that notwithstanding Mr. McCourt suggests there are various ways that this could be set up. We would ask the cabinet and those involved in setting that up that they set it up with the maximum amount of transparency and with the optimum amount of assurance allowing our own auditors to So I'm sure, I don't think it takes amends, but I'm sure we would want to emphasise that. I have a couple of questions, and I think it goes back to the reason for recommendation, which is to provide the members with assurance the council is taking and that we have sufficient resource to do that. Go back on the minutes on page 5. If you remember, we were told there was a review of spending taking place and that there was a vacancy panel consisting of 3 members who were overseeing and determining which vacancies get through the gate or not, which in itself puts a delay into making appointments and so on. Go save some money, I suppose, because we're paying that salary. I suppose something from Mark to tell us, or we need the director to tell us that that hasn't impacted the audit service and we haven't lost any capacity, given what you then go on to say around the referrals. I just agree with Angela, really, in terms of trying to understand what some of that's about. And also, I think you'll know this, Mark, in terms of some of my concern about audits that have been closed and whether they've been appropriately closed and so on. So perhaps there's something there. If we do go into a private session, we can have a look at that in terms of who's making decisions to close things and, you know, what goes to the police, what doesn't, and what then follows, so we're not living with nugatory work. I'm sure you understand what I'm asking here, Mark, and I'm necessarily happy to talk about it, but I'll be guided by Mr.
I do have the facility within the resources that I have available to move resources around where the risk is greater and where I feel it's most appropriately utilised. So I have no concerns in this precise one.
Sorry, Adrian, just quickly, I just wanted to, on that particular issue, are we carrying any vacancies at the moment, Mark, and did they have to go through the panel?
No, we're not carrying any vacancies.
Can I just follow on from Jeff? I think got the bit out to agree with you, Jeff. It's not on that one, but on the point about the Wirral Group partnership going forward, that is a part of an identity. It should then come under the council rules for audit and risk, so it should actually come through this committee in some form or other that we can audit this and evaluate the risk around this company. The appropriate way it should be given, whether I don't think the legal people, because obviously it's going to be set up with a legal point, but somebody's got to audit it, somebody's got to check the risk of it, and I think it's as is part of the body, it should be us that's doing that role.
On one of those, Chair, yes.
Okay, thank you, Bill.
That's what I have said.
That's a good answer. Phil.
Sorry, it was the last meeting, and the issue that was in my mind is things that, surprises that come out of the woodwork, or whatever they are. And at the meeting earlier this year, we talked about the basis on which the plan arrangements and the transfer were done, and then in July, there was much discussion about this. And one thing that's not, I didn't come across in the reports or the minute. I haven't had time to watch anyone's recordings in the minutes. But was only a few weeks ago when pouring over cabinet papers, I found that we had to find about £300,000 to pay back to the company that had invested in the depot to make it serviceable for staff. And because that somehow improved or bettered the building, we got to pay them back for the money they spent out of the contract. We got emerged either earlier in the year when we first started exploring this, or in the July meeting. So I don't really mention Mark Jordy or I. So when there's things that I think are popping up out of the woodwork, you know, my God, they lift a stone and there's only woodlice enjoying themselves, the same sort of issue drops me on. We lift a stone and there's various things visibly underneath it. No offence to anyone. Didn't apply things of hit, it's just that I didn't get the fact that this was going to happen to us when I went through the paperwork we had. And if it was explained in the meeting, I'm sorry, I just didn't.
I think it's more an observation than a question.
That's very fast.
Good observation. Okay, I just wanted to be clear about that observation.
Well, the question is, when this committee, when this committee or the audit committee or you as chair of audit are sitting on some body, sitting in on meetings of the growth company, carrying out a sort of observer status, I really want to explore how the council will keep an eye on this partnership. We're relying on the great knowledge of the directors and those who may sit as observers, but for members' assurances, perhaps we'll come to it on that item, we just want to have some feeling the thing isn't running away from us.
Okay, well, Chair, all those comments are all going to be recorded.
Yes,
in fact, Chair, I've got something I think might help, given what Ron and I have in common cause on this. I did see some nodding of heads. So, is it possible that we can move something at the back of this, if we're finishing off, that given the item 132A, that this committee would urge Cabinet to ensure maximum transparency in its arrangements for the development of the Wirral Growth Company, or the setting up of the Wirral Growth Company, and openness to our internal audit service. So at least we're formally on the record of having said that's the type of incorporation, whether it's a partnership, whatever it is, they're the type of arrangements that we would want to see.
If in what you just said, I particularly noted you were saying you were using the term urge transparency.
Yes.
Okay, the reason why this committee can't find that very fit and decide whether they all agree that we should urge transparency. I shouldn't imagine any of us would disagree with it.
And an openness to our internal audit service.
Okay. Yeah. We'd like to read that. We'll say that.
Thank you.
We all agreed that we would urge transparency and we would wish our internal auditors to have the access we would naturally expect.
I'll second that.
Sure. I'm not sure it was a proposition.
It was, I was doing it.
Okay, just in that case, have we all agreed?
Service, and they are apparently, I'm informed by a number of people,
say this has to be located locally for each of residents?
Yes, that would certainly be my response to you, Councillor. I sort of think very late on this afternoon, made some initial inquiries with colleagues in procurement, and they provided me with the assurance comments that, yes, the contract expired on the 31st of March 2019, and no reason why we start to sort of look at certain exercises for obtaining this tender, that this is factored into the consideration.
Can I ask a question on page, on same on page 28, and it's section council tax and housing benefit processing agents. Can somebody explain to me what it means? Because I tried to read this and I didn't process.
So, I was actually in the middle of editing Councillor Liz Grey's.
I'm certainly happy that we're going to process this. I'm sorry, but I have a
question. I've got another question. This one regards page 34. It's possibly just my inputs on research and last, but it looks like we're spending 1.3 million on 300 service grade bundles. And knowing how much a service grade bundle costs, being significantly less than that, I was just wondering where the rest of the money's going.
Sorry, but which one? Sorry,
page 34.
Client devices.
Can I mention that I responded to this off the top of my head, and I would want better qualified information than I gave.
My question was slightly different. My question was not something I'm very grateful for the service group, because I think they're needed. I think people work more effectively with them. So I wasn't questioning the actual purchase of service group bundles. It's much needed. I was just wondering where the additional where the cost is going, where the money's going.
Well, we'll do that. Having spoken to colleagues from Digital later on before I arrived here, they advised me that the wording is not very good to be truthful in the narrative. The 300 service, I mean, the 1.3 million is for the whole of the exercise, it's replacements for everybody's service program. The initial order was for 300, of which 300,000 of the 1.3 billion has been spent, and that 300,000 relates to those 300 service pros, converting Windows 8 to Windows 12 the servers, repositioning some of the old laptops. There are many, many more purchases on the way. I say that there's £1 million plus available still within that budget for that whole kind of initiative. So you rest assured that there's 300.
It's not quite what it used to be as first blush. Can I just support Liz on that? Because I think that's a really interesting point. And I've spoken previously about some of our projects and programmes, and I'm presuming this has been managed as some sort of project. Is it possible for us to have a deeper dive into this whole renewal of technology and who's getting what and how many and where's the money going and how are we going to do some of this stuff? Because it is 2.6 million, because this 1.3 is part of the 2.6, isn't it? So would it be possible just to have a bit of a one-off look at one of those areas? Because this is a big area of spending, it would be interesting to see.
I'm sure it's a big range, but I don't see why not. We all know that the systems we have at the moment, we're 7 years already, way past its shelf life, and that the Lenovo laptops that we have are also getting elderly now by the sort of thing they were. Because the way we're going at the moment, we're also looking very closely cost benefits that we can get out of the reduced use of paper. And if we can develop far more paperless work in committees, there's a big saving to be made there as well. That's a big part of the whole story. It's not just simply a matter of replacing the equipment. Of course, we've also replaced the backup, because the original backup, some years ago, was in the same building as the main business. can't invite colleagues to come along at some point and provide me with the URFA. What I will say is that the initiative came through the members' equipment steering group, who oversaw the needs in relation to the Ukrainian replacement of.
Yeah, just to be clear, I'm not talking about the kits that have been handed to members, and I'm sure that wasn't Liz's point either. It was a wider point about what we're doing in terms of the project for replacing IT kit and probably infrastructure, because again, I'm sure Liz will tell you that a lot of this stuff is now being it's commodities, and the cost of those commodities are coming down all the time. So just to have a look at how we've managed that procurement process, I think it would be a good exercise, a big chunk, 2.6 million on IT, and I'm sure the public want to know that we are kind of looking at this to make sure it's being spent properly, the kids go to the right places, and what we're doing with this. So it's a cracking spot.
Okay, Phil will be next.
On the issue of the equipment, I'd like to declare an interest as a member of the improvement board for student insurance services. But from wearing a hat in that location, I'm aware that there's a rollout of equipment in stages to key social workers, now about 300 to 400, we keep coming waves, who are working more agilely and just using check lines as a down place to get out of it again, and go and look after children, interview the children and their parents and carers and all the rest of it. So I can see where lots of the equipment's gone. I think the progress report, the colleagues are looking for to see how it's actually going and being used and whether it's ready for money. There were a few things I wanted to raise on the report of the HR. The first is the many housing associations and bodies that are organisations from YMCA for and lots of housing associations having tenders in batches with extensions over time.
Do I need to be talking about the association? Do I need to declare a an interest.
I can't remember the magenta is for you, sir, but the Liberal Methodist is, for example.
Well, we might have competed for it, sir.
That's right. So there are many organisations that public health, and it's, the officers are mentioned there, and Lisa Newman, have successions of contracts over time, which I've noted in earlier reports over the last year or so. And I assume that, working on the basis that that those specialist organisations are offering high levels of care and involvement with people that turn up at the door from the arts, the YMC, whatever. So there aren't other sort of competing providers opening up an alternative venue competing for work, working in both commons or like service. So I don't know whether, because this is a regular thing, we shouldn't in fact be negotiating some sort of block contract arrangement with these bodies over a long period to give some certainty to those bodies, but also make sure that we're providing the right sort of cost place that we support. So if I could get an understanding of why we have these different chunks, because several times it talks about the contracts being redesigned or rewritten, restructured and so on. So picking up those themes, I don't want to create more work for these human housing thing, but I'm thinking in the long run, if we have a series of operation block contracts, it might be beneficial to us, in fact, less paper chase to organise it. So I've worked on a point on that. If it's then appropriate to bring Jeff back in when we finish that point, there's another point on a different issue.
I don't think that was really a question, so it was an observation. I think it's taken on board from.
Can I move our question? Can I ask a couple of questions? One, regarding some of these reports that are dated, so they've already been happening and dated. So you get something in like March 8th to 18. Why are these people being reported so late to us? Because they're information, because the matter's happened and done, and there's nothing that we can do about it. Finished, started 1st of December 17, ending 2018. It's all the way through the going back to my original question, and it was the council tax down to benefit processing agents and the temporary contract. And the original contract was ceased on the 5th of February with, I think it was it match up? Make sure you're already calling and it has been given to Meditech. But the fact is, what did the original contract cost us? Has there been any saving the improvement across the new provider? And on that scale, is that long enough period to cover the backlog that we should have within that it says here and how you have been?
Sure, I think almost by definition these things have to be respected. I think sharing is the best way to answer that, don't you?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Also, if you first conferred about the dates, so it is a retrospective report, and all of these contract waivers or exemptions have all been agreed, they're more or less all in place now and started. It's a regular 6-monthly report, so it comes in 6-month waves. So this is the October 2017. To the March 2018. So you'll get another one in another couple of months, which is from April 2018 until the end of September this month as well. So it's all retrospective. All the contract agreements and all the ways have been agreed in line with the appropriate delegated approval within contract procedure rules and financial notes as well. So it is a report for information, but obviously you have your rights to call in and ask for some more information about individual items. Just on the Meritech, the one, this is one that I do know something about, it's actually within my team. So when we source agency staff, we normally source them through the contract with a company called Matrix, which is a framework across the Liverpool City region. So all the councils use it. We advertise for agency staff on there and we use them for a certain amount of time. This is specifically for the backlogs of housing benefit claims. We did try and source the staff through the Matrix contract, but there was nobody available with the skills that we needed. So what we've done is gone out to another company, so it's more of a specialist company that provides housing benefit staff, and these are called Meritech. So it's Matrix and Meritech. It's quite difficult when you're looking at the things and what's going on. But they are an agency provider of staff. I think, I'm going to have to chat into this too about